Hey, I'm Grump. And I'm the Game Grump.
Hey, you fucking sassy Sundays. Welcome back to Game fucking Grumps. My name's Arin. This is just Game Grump. Just one Grump. Just me. And I have a feeling it's gonna get real weird. Like, when I'm just like talking to myself, because I talk to myself all the time in like the car and shit. Or like the shower. Or I'm making breakfast or something and nobody else is up. I just get bored. So I just start talking to myself and I start like rehearsing lines or like coming up with new voices or like, you know, I don't know, fucking singing songs. I don't know if anybody's heard like the I'm Peeing song that I did a long time ago. That was like one of the random songs that I came up with. It's like, and I'm peeing and I'm peeing and I'm peeing and I'm peeing, it feels good. It's just because I was peeing one day and I decided that I would sing about it. And usually, sometimes I'll do it even in public, so there are times when I'm like, I'm particularly loopy or lucid, and I'm, just in the public restroom, and there's a bunch of people in there, and I'm just like, man, oh yeah, peeing out my dick. If you go to the title screen here, you can see, there's like, it shows you where everything is. There's like information, right? It's kind of cool. So, and actually, if you, so like, you see here, like, Storm Eagle's stage is like this airship, and it's like hovering in this fucking area or whatever. And then Spark Mandrill's stage is right here. If you beat Storm Eagle's stage, his airship fucking crashes on Spark Mandrill's stage, and then like half of the shit doesn't work, in the stage. And then, it's the same for Chill Penguin, so if you beat- so Chill Penguin's stage is up here and Flame Mammoth's stage is down here. So if you beat Chill Penguin's stage, I guess there's like a landslide. And then, like, the avalanche comes down and covers all over Flame Mammoth's stage. So, it just, like, gets all icy and, like, all the lava gets all fucked up. It's crazy, dude. Like, this game is full of, like, little fucking polish. Like, it's so polished. It's a shame, like, you know, a lot of games aren't like this anymore. Just the little attention to detail. And what's cool about the attention to detail, too, is it affects the game, right? Because there's one thing about, like, visual polish or, like, story polish or something like that. But the fact that, like, there's polish in every aspect of, like, how you play the game is really fucking impressive to me. And I really enjoy it, personally. I moved to California specifically to get into voiceover work. Because that's sort of what I thought my future was in terms of, like, the career and everything. Like, I really liked, animating and, like, making videos for like Newgrounds and YouTube and stuff, but I didn't think it would be like a career, you know. I just thought it was sort of a hobby. And maybe a little extra cash on the side. But Jesus fuck. Good. This guy's hard. So I thought voiceover work was gonna be my thing. And when the videos picked up, I didn't really pursue professional voiceover work at all after that because I didn't need to. I was like, oh well, this is Jesus Christ, how do you fight this guy? So, finally I'm doing professional voiceover work and I fucking love it. It feels like, you know, everything I've done up to this point has sort of been me, like, practicing for it, you know? Because, you know, I talk all day and I do silly voices all day. And, you know, we do, like, you know, live-action film bits and stuff and shit like that. And that's also, like, really decent practice. For this kind of stuff. And plus I'm like taking acting lessons now, which is crazy. I was actually really nervous about taking acting lessons because, I don't know anything about acting. I'll be perfectly honest with you. I've done voiceover work, you know, and that's acting in its own way. What the fuck were they saying? Oh yeah. I'm taking acting lessons and I was really nervous because, to me, and my acting teacher has sort of told this to me as well, is it's not like a trade like plumbing or something where like, you know, there's a way to do it, you know, there's like facts about it that you just have to like put in your brain and then you know it, right? And then you just sort of practice those facts out. Fuck this guy, God, he's hard. Acting is it's something you just have to like do over and over again with like things in mind. Basically, what I'm saying is I don't know how you would go about teaching acting. In the same way, like, I don't know how you would go about teaching singing. So I've taken a couple singing lessons, and I'm not anywhere near where I should be, but, it's interesting to me, this world where it's like these things. And I think that's why people think like, oh, you know, he's got born talent because he can sing. So they think it's like this sort of like genetic thing or whatever, like singing or drawing or whatever. But it's like, no, you can teach it. It's just, it's weird. You can tell I've been doing this for a little while and now I'm just like, I just gotta beat this. whoa, that thing's cool in the background. I never really noticed that. It's like a spaceship or something. I love shit like that. I love like retro future shit. When Mass Effect first came out, I was really into it because there's something about it that felt very like 80s. Even though it was sort of like, had kind of like a modern feel to it too. Something about like the music and then also like the aesthetics of the armor. And like just how it was shot. There was something like really lonely about that game, which I really enjoyed. I don't know why, I really like lonely stuff. Maybe because as a kid I always felt sort of alone. Because I was like, I was in my own room and, I never really knew how to talk to people. I never really was taught how to talk to people. Flay Mammoth is a super interesting bot. I love how I'm going like super deep and then I'm just like, video games!
Just talking a little bit about video games, you know, because I like them so much. I might seem like I don't, but
it's just because I don't like most modern games. That's the thing. And I don't hate them. I just, they're not very interesting to me. Because they're all really similar. And I guess that's not a fair, critique. It probably goes a little deeper than that, because like, I pretty much almost automatically like all platformers just because I like the genre, and they're all the same. They're all very similar. So, again, that's not fair. But, I think it's just because also, they're similar in ways that I don't enjoy. Like, I enjoy platformers, but I don't enjoy, goddamn, I don't enjoy the things that are similar about most modern games. I don't enjoy that they're very cinematic. I don't enjoy, like quick time things. I don't enjoy shooting very much. I enjoy shooting when it's like really engaging. I'm really into Overwatch. Super engaging, super fast twitch. It's skill based. You know, I was really into like Unreal Tournament. I really liked Tribes. Really into Tribes, all the different Tribes. But those are like twitch, you know. Call of Duty isn't Twitch, I feel like. Maybe competitive Call of Duty. And I don't even dislike playing Call of Duty like multiplayer, I just don't like the single player. But then like games like Uncharted, like I feel like are just fucking just not even games. Like, whoa. Obviously they are. I'm just making a broad sort of statement where it's like, I don't feel challenged when I'm playing an Uncharted game. I feel like I'm wasting time. I feel like I'm just doing things and then it's over, you know? And then when it gets to a hard part, it's just boringly hard. It's not like engagingly hard. It's like, I know what I have to do. I just gotta do it. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, you know? Like, and especially in the cases of those games, Uncharted or like Tomb Raider or whatever, where there's like a million dudes and they all sort of like have their own AI, so they're not like always in the same spot, but like sometimes they are. So you can sort of plan your route or whatever, and there's like some strategy to it. But like, you know that there's a point where you can sort of just brute force it, and in most cases that is the case. Like if you just kind of run up and kill them and do this, and oh it doesn't work, and try it again, and then you know that one worked a little bit better. Like you can just keep doing it. You don't really need to plan around it. Whereas like games where there is a situation where you're fighting a boss and you really have to plan, there's no way you could brute force it, right? Like, there's no way I could brute force this, right? I have to pay attention to what he's doing. I have to pay attention to, like, where he's gonna go next. There's no way I can just fucking mindlessly, just keep shooting at him and make sure it works. Whereas in Uncharted or Tomb Raider, that is the case. Like, there are some situations where, and in a lot of cases, games like that, and like Resident Evil 4, and not that I'm knocking Resident Evil 4, that game fucking rocks, but, they will lower the difficulty for you, if you're not doing so hot. Plus I just find those games, like, aesthetically boring. You're just fighting dudes over and over again. Like, in a game like this, I'm fighting a fucking weird chameleon that does different things, and then throughout the stage, there was like little rock men, and they did different things, and like rocks came down from the ceiling and fucking tried to squash me, and then there's a god damn it, I really gotta focus on this. I'm sorry, I'm ranting about video games. Oh shit, I can't make it on this one. How many lives do I have? 6. Yeah, all right, I think I'm good. What the fuck was I saying? Oh yeah. So, you know, honestly, if there was a game like Uncharted that was aesthetically more interesting, like, if I was in some kind of fucking weird fantasy world and, like, it wasn't just a bunch of dudes with guns, it was, like, fucking weird, like, robots that this one jumped up high and hit the ceiling and did, I mean, I'm just saying as an example, just off the top of my head. You know, these little guys do, so you have to crouch and get them, or something like that. And then there's a bunch of variety. That'd be great. And I think I'd probably play that game and enjoy it to some degree. There's, you know, it's just, I don't know. I can't make one broad sweeping statement about games like that, even though I do it all the time. In reality, there's so much that goes into why I don't really enjoy playing those games. And I could make a whole fucking thing about it. I don't know.
You son of a bitch.
No! Ooh! What is he doing? What is he doing? He's doing this shit. You fuck! You robot fuck! Yeah! Suck my fucking blue dick, you green motherfucker! I don't know why it went to a racial place. I had a dream the other night that I was hanging out with Obama. I'm just gonna throw that out there. I don't even care about politics. I literally don't know shit about Obama or what he's done, but I just, for some reason, I was in some cool, fucking, rich, wealthy hotel room, because he was doing it, because he's the fucking president, and he was just chilling, and I was like, yo, what's up, Obama? And he was like, yo, what up with you? And I was like, man, doesn't it suck that you're gonna have to leave the White House? And he was like, oh man, I fucking love that place, dude, this is gonna suck, you know? And it was like, it was so cool, and I was like, oh man, dude. Obama's chill as fuck. But dream Obama, not real. I don't know about real Obama. I'm sure he's stressed out as hell. 8 years as president? Fuck, dude. I can't even imagine. I've only been doing Game Grumps for like 4 years, and I'm stressed as fuck. And that's not saying I don't enjoy it. I'm just saying, like, you know, being Mr. fucking boss man of like a team of like 10 people can get a little stressful. But anyway. But I love it. I'm not gonna fucking, I mean, if I didn't love it, I wouldn't do it. It's the thing. You know, I used to do solo panels a lot, because I was just Ego Raptor, and I just made cartoons, and people would invite me to cons, and then I'd have people show up. And I was really proud of those, honestly, because I sort of got a reputation of my panels being, like, some of the best panels, at the cons, because, I would do a Q&A, but I have such a comedy improv background that I would try to like tell stories and tell jokes and stuff, so it was more sort of like seeing like a Henry Rollins show or something, or like a stand-up show, where I was always in it to entertain. You know, whenever I went to a panel and somebody was just answering questions, I was always bored out of my fucking mind, even if I was interested in what they were saying, because it's just like the format is so boring. But like whenever I did a solo panel, I would stand up, you know, I would hold the mic, I would walk around the stage, and I would just riff on people and crack and try to make everyone laugh, you know, because at the end of the day, you're waiting in line for a thing that's an hour. Like it should be a show, at least at the very least, it should be entertaining. That's how I always felt. So I always loved doing that stuff, and I haven't really done it in a while, just because of the nature of Game Grumps. You know, we're a group. You know, even if it's just me and Dan, it's still me and Dan. And there are some circumstances. In most cases, I'm sort of a... I'm a lot more... Honestly, it's weird. I'm an introverted guy. Dan is actually, I would say, more introverted than I am. But he came up in an environment where he was taught how to talk to people. You know, his family is very gregarious. And he had a lot of, like, local friends, you know, coming up in comedy, he met a lot of people and had to collaborate with a lot of people, and he was in bands, so he had to do that as well. Whereas I was always a loner. You know, I had my very small group of friends, and my parents were not very gregarious. So I never really learned the abilities to have conversations, have talk to people and stuff. You know, I was always a nice guy, but I had, you know, also inherent insecurities about like my self-worth and stuff. So sort of feeling like I deserved to talk to people, on top of the fact that I didn't even know how to talk to people, was sort of a recipe for not talking to people. So what I'm getting at is there's sort of this weird thing where like I feel like I'm actually less introverted than Dan, but Dan came up with the skills of talking to people, so he just does it more by sheer skill, right? Like, if I say, for example, I feel like it makes enough sense as it is. What the fuck was I getting at? Oh yeah. Oh, okay. So the point is, when Dan and I do things together, like panels or whatever, he sort of naturally takes over, which is which I don't mind, honestly, because I don't, fuck it. Like, like, he's funny, he's entertaining, like, as long as he's entertaining the crowd, and I'm there too. But if it's just me, then, you know, I gotta bring my A game, right? Like, I gotta really... And I know how to entertain a crowd, and I know how to talk and tell stories. Then I'm just like, alright, here we go, fucking crank it up to 11. And I like that, honestly. There's something very, satisfying of... And even in this circumstance where I'm doing the show alone, there's something very satisfying about the pressure of having to perform about this is me. And I've always wondered, I've never been told this by other people, but I've always felt this way, where if I'm in a group conversation where there are three or more people, I actually don't talk much. And that's not to say that talking is important in a... Well, whatever. I don't talk much, right? I don't engage much. Okay, that's the better thing to say. I don't engage much. I just kind of sit back and I'm just like, yeah, I won't say much. But in a one-on-one, there's that pressure to communicate, and I actually enjoy that, because then it's like, okay, well, I have to engage now, because it's not natural for me to engage. I have to make the choice. Like, my resting state isn't engaging in a conversation like that. Whereas with some people, like, for example, I would say Dan, it is. So I love being on one-on-one conversations, because then I'm like, I'm fully engaged. I'm like, I have to turn it on, and I'm like, all right, boom. And that's not to say that it's fake or anything. It's just that, like, it's not my natural state. I do have to put effort into it, but I enjoy putting effort into it, right? Whereas in a group situation, I don't have to put effort into it. Everyone else is doing the work, and that's fine. Because I got fucking ADD, and my brain goes a mile a minute, you know, thinking about other shit. That's basically it. So I really enjoy having one-on-one conversations with people. Because then I'm like, oh man, and I'm like thinking about the shit that they say. And that's not to say also in a conversation with other people, I'm always listening. Just like, for example, I won't like ask questions as much or even at all, in a group conversation, right? Whereas in a one-on-one conversation, like, I'm engaged and I want this conversation to continue. So I will ask questions and I'm genuinely interested. But like, you know, in a group conversation, the other person's usually doing the work for me, so I don't have to, but I'm still listening. That makes sense. I hope that doesn't seem rude or anything, but that's just... It's just the energy that I'm willing to put out. And if it's a situation where, like, obviously I have to make a good impression, I'm really fucking not paying attention to this fight and I'm gonna lose. If it's a situation where I have to, like, make a good impression, and I have to stand out, like, for example, if we're taking a meeting or something, like, I take so many meetings... That's one thing that I had to, this is tangential, but that's one thing I had to, this is a 15-minute episode, that's one thing I had to sort of come to terms with, being, like, the owner of Game Grumps and being this sort of entity now, is, I take so many meetings, like, creative or otherwise, that don't amount to anything, you know? And it's like, I take them because they might amount to something, but, like, I would go through days where I would just be exhausted because I was working all day and I felt like I wasn't doing anything, but I realized it was because I was taking fucking meetings, that didn't mean anything, that could mean something, but didn't mean anything, It was less frustrating once I realized that simple fact, but it was like very frustrating because I came from a world where work was sitting down and doing the fucking thing, you know? It was a trade. It was it was quantifiable. It was like, how much animation did I do today? How much voice, how many jokes did I tell today? You know? Whereas a meeting is like, how many fucking people that I'd sniff asses with today. But once I realized that, I felt a lot better about it. It's a very strange world to live in, the entertainment world, or any world where you're representing a business or like you have to make connections or whatever. It's very strange, and I like it to an extent, but I just enjoy the creative aspect of it, which is sort of why I took a backseat to that process of it. But, you know, there are things about it I enjoy. I realize I sort of like providing things for other people. You know, in most cases, I think that, creative people aren't brought up, believing, that, like, anything is possible or, like, that people want to help them out. Which I think is really sort of sad. Because the world is run on creativity, right? So, I realize that I like, providing for people, for creative people in general, because like I said, there's this weird sort of intrinsicness to, creativity and, a lack of self-worth. I don't know if there's a cause and effect of it, but it definitely seems like creative people sort of get shit on socially, in a mainstream way. You know, most parents or most, I don't know, normies, I guess this is a horrible way to say it, but, creativity in most cases, I feel like, is only supported in the niche. In the everyday, day-to-day life of people, creativeness is sort of looked down upon, a little bit, and unencouraged because it's indulgent. But it's not indulgent, it's you need it. I think everybody needs it. I certainly do. So I always wanted to create a situation where, people could feel free to create, you know, uninhibited. And that's tough, and I certainly haven't gotten there yet, but I do what I can. In the case of, like, the Game Grumps Animateds, I want people to feel, that they have a voice, that they have a platform, that they have something that they help promote, their art, and also get creative. Because of the Game Grumps Animateds, I'm just like, choose whatever bit you want, do whatever you want, there's a 99% chance I'm gonna say fucking yes to, whatever you did. I think there's, like, literally only, I've only ever given, like, one note on an animation, and it was just because, like, there was something that, like, I didn't think would fly with the audience. Like, that was, like, literally it. But anyway, with Cutie Saturday, you know, it's a hashtag I started on Twitter where I just encourage people to draw cute girls on Saturday. You can beat these up, by the way. Boom. There's a secret up on the top one. That's what I just always felt. I guess when I was a kid, I wanted somebody to tell me I could do anything and I should do anything. And in a lot of cases, my parents did, but at the same time, there was sort of this, like, maybe you should consider doing something that isn't artistic just in case. Which I think can be harmful. It certainly was for me, because I didn't fully commit to something for a long time, until I found animation through Newgrounds and stuff. That's when I fully committed to something because it started paying off for me. And I was like, well, if it's already paying off right now and nothing else in my life is paying off, then I might as well stick to this. But also the more important thing is, I think that that might be the wrong way to go about looking at things because, and I've always said this whenever somebody asks like advice on being an artist or an animator or let's player or whatever the fuck, the number one thing is you should do it because you enjoy it. I think most people choose to do it because it seems maybe a little easier. And maybe because it's more enjoyable, obviously, than being like a fucking accountant or something. Although, if you enjoy that, then that's great. But you should really definitely enjoy the act of doing the thing. Like, I enjoy animating. I enjoy fucking playing video games, obviously. I enjoy talking into a microphone. I enjoy doing voices. I would be doing it anyway if I wasn't doing it professionally, right? And I think that's the key, because when it comes to fucking life, right, like, it's just all about being happy. You can't be happy, you know, I could dash jump over him, but he's just being a fucking, being a cunt right now. There we go. Yeah, it's just, what is your goal? What does success mean to you? Does it mean money? Okay, if it means money, then what does money mean to you? Does it mean happiness? Like, it always leads to happiness as far as I'm concerned. Maybe that's not the case for other people, but it certainly seems like it, and it definitely is the case for me, that happiness is the key, right? So if you stick to doing something that you enjoy and you're happy doing, even if you're living in fucking squalor, which I certainly was for a while, I still, even though I was really depressed, that was for different reasons. I enjoyed doing the things that I was doing. I really enjoyed drawing. I really enjoyed, doing silly voices. I enjoyed making videos. You know, that's why I did them. I didn't make Sequelitis because I thought it would be super successful. In fact, I didn't think anybody would like it. There was just shit I wanted to say. So I said it. And then people seemed to pick up on it. And then again, that was going to lead me into a statement that I was going to say, but I'm not going to say it. I was going to say, if you do that, then people will come, you know? Like, and I feel like that's the advice that a lot of people, give to artists. Like, that's the second tier of, like, we'll do it for you argument. But I want to take it to the third tier and say, like, don't even. Just do it. Like, forget everybody else. If it does good, whatever, it's completely unrelated as far as I'm concerned. Like, you know, what I mean to say is, like, in the example of Sequelitis I just gave, I did Sequelitis because I wanted to do it, right? And I made the second one because I wanted to do it. I made the third one because I wanted to do it. It was the popularity of it that sort of made me not want to do it anymore. Like, I wanted to do it because I felt like I was expressing myself about games. I had things I wanted to say about games, and I said it. And I was really proud of the fact that I said it, and I was really happy with how I said it. And it was fun. But it was sort of like, people wanted to start, like, arguing with me, and I sort of, like, was getting this, like, reputation of being this, like, whiny guy or, like, really opinionated guy, which is whatever, but, like, I didn't want that. That wasn't my goal. My goal was just to talk about games. You know, and it's like, yeah, well, it's like, of course, man, you have this audience, and you create these videos that are really opinionated, of course you're gonna get people saying like that. Yeah, obviously. But, you know, it wasn't until it happened that I sort of realized what it actually meant. It's probably because, it got so popular that I stopped making them at all. It's weird, right? Like, you wouldn't think that. I'm about to fight Vile, by the way. Stay back, Axel, take him on. And then he fucking dies. Spoilers. Oh god, I wonder if I can beat Vile with only the Buster. Holy shit. That's gonna be tough. He's weak against Spark Mandrill, I believe. But usually at this point I have the Hadouken, so I try to kill him with that. It's another scripted fight, by the way. Anyway. So yeah, I highly recommend doing something because you enjoy doing it. Not because you think it's gonna bring you fame or money or it's gonna get you to the top or whatever fucking weird reason. All you gotta think of is the straight line to happiness. Do you enjoy doing this? And then it can get more complicated in that, like, okay, well, I enjoy drawing sometimes, right? And then other times I don't enjoy drawing. But is it worth it to stick it out for the times that I don't enjoy it so that I get better for the times that I do enjoy it? And in that circumstance, I would say yes. And I think that's something that a lot of people struggle with. Because of their self-worth, and they drawing is an extension of yourself, and when you do a drawing that you don't like, you hate yourself. You don't hate the drawing. I mean, you say you do, but what do you really feel? Just do shit because you like it, man. That's how I feel. And that's what I do. And more and more I'm doing that and doing things that I enjoy. And also, there's another aspect of it too that's like very zen, where, oh man, I might have to concentrate on this. Yeah, there's another like Jesus! Did you see that? He did fucking half my health! Oh my god, this is gonna be insane. Alright. Cool. Fuck! Alright, I'll see if I can. I got him down to half health, so maybe I'll be able to do it. But, there's another very zen aspect of life too, where, you sort of have to take it as it comes, right? Like, there are things to enjoy about things that you maybe don't enjoy. And that takes a lot of also knowing who you are and, sort of being at peace with literally everything. And for me, that's been, like, meditation. I meditate frequently. There was a time where I meditated every day. Sometimes, multiple times in a day. This is a nightmare. I don't as much anymore because I don't feel like I need it as much anymore. But finding the joy in things that maybe you wouldn't find joy in. And I think there is a common thread with people where it's acceptable to sort of whine about things, and that maybe perpetuates not enjoying things, not seeing things for what they are. Fuck! Whew! There are a lot of things now where, you know, for example, somebody will ask me, like, do you want to go do this? And I know that they want to do it, but I don't. But at the same time, what else am I going to do, you know? It's like, in my mind, I can't really offer an alternative. You know, if I can, then I'm like, no, I wanted to read. Or something like that. But in the circumstances where I'm just like sitting around and I'm just taking up space. And then somebody's like, you want to do something and I don't want to do it. I'm like, well, I might as well because I'm not really doing anything else. And I know that I can find something that I enjoy about it. Even if right now I'm like, my impulse is that I don't want to do it, right? Maybe that doesn't make sense, but it makes sense to me. And it'll help you have more experiences and enjoy life a lot more, because there's so many circumstances where you're going to be forced to do something that you don't want to do, and the, oh, I have zero lives. And you just got to accept it and do it. And the best way to do it is to find something to enjoy about it. You know, like a job, or like, I don't know, just anything. Stand in a line at the DMV, you know? There's something to enjoy about that. I know it sounds fucking crazy, but, like, why not? Why not find something to enjoy about it? Why be miserable about it? Why? There's no reason to. It just makes you miserable, and nobody wants to be miserable. I don't want to be miserable. I certainly don't. So fucking make a joke about it or something. I don't know. Anyway, I'm gonna fight fucking Vile. Well, the thing that came to mind first was that, like, when I talk about deep things, we usually get more, emails and tweets from people saying, like, I'm in a bad spot, and they want help, and, you know, I can't do that, I really can't help anybody. I'm not qualified, and I just don't have the time. And I think it would probably do more harm than good for me to half-heartedly help somebody while I fucking have to live my own life. But I have recommendations. Please seek help. Psychiatric help is nothing to be ashamed of. I have had it many times. I've gone to several different forms of therapy. And again, you know, even when I say that, my first impulse is to be like, I'm not crazy. But I'm not. And I don't think anybody that goes to therapy is crazy. I think we live in a crazy world, where a lot is expected of us. And, I think in most circumstances, you know, why did I do this without getting one-ups? I'm such an idiot. In most circumstances, parents, it's their first time, you know, like, if they're having a kid for the sixth time, it's like, oh, they get it, they get how to give the kid love and everything, but like, the first time, I mean, fuck, who knows how to be a good parent? That's fucking tough, and parenting is so fucking important for the kid, the whole person's rest of their lives. Shit. I mean, shit, dude, like, can you imagine? I mean, I can't even, my parents were great. And I'm pretty sure that's why I turned out alright. Because they were very loving and understanding, you know? I can't even imagine not having loving and understanding parents. I can't imagine having not my parents. So, I mean, and it's not just that. It's everything else in life. It's the pressures of life. It's school. It's, shit doesn't make sense. Like, I don't agree with, I don't think school is great. You know, I think there's a lot to gain from it, but the way it's set up right now, I don't agree with it. And to grow up with that, this sort of creeping sense that like something's wrong. Like I'm going to this thing every day and I don't feel like I'm gaining anything from it. Like that's frustrating. And that can't be good for your mental health, you know? Then zero dies, the end. Oh man, what a bummer. If you feel like something's wrong, if you feel like, look man, you should be happy, alright? That's what I'm saying right now. You should be happy, and if you're not happy, then you should consider that something might be wrong. And I don't mean, and I'm not saying wrong with you. That's the quickest way to stay unhappy, is to think that there's something wrong with you and you're fucked up. That's not the case. There's something wrong, alright? You should be happy, is what I'm saying. And you're not broken for not being happy. There's just something that needs to be looked at, right? Something that needs to be examined. This is where I need the dash boot. So seek help, right? Like, and what I'm saying is the only excuse that you need to get help is that you're not happy. You should be happy. That's all I'm saying. I'm happy, and I wasn't for a long time. I really wasn't, and there was a time where it really came to a head, and it was very hard. And being in the public eye, especially being scrutinized for decisions that I was forced into, or that I had to make for the good of the people in my life, you know, stuff like that. I already had issues with my own self-worth and my ability to make decisions like that, right? So, it was extremely important to me to get help, on that front. And, you know, I mentioned it on the Philly D show. I wear this bracelet. I actually haven't worn it in a couple days because, it fell off. I have to rebind it. But I wear this bracelet that says self-worth on it to remind myself, oh my god, I have to fight all the bosses again. To remind myself that I am worthy of my own, or no, it's a self-love on it, I'm sorry, that I have to love myself, because there was a long time where I didn't, and I have to, you know, like, I have to if I want to enjoy this life that I've been given, because it's gonna be over one day, and if I'm sitting there dying, and I'm like, man, I really didn't have a good time, that's gonna fucking suck. And there's no excuse for that. Like, I don't care what, like, pressures or, like, who's expecting what of you. There's no excuse for when you're fucking, you're laying there dying and you aren't satisfied. Right? Like, there's no excuse. Why would you want to waste your this gift that you've been given of life to fucking have a miserable time, and to be okay with that? Like, if you think that you don't deserve a happy life, that's fucked, man. The only way that you're gonna have a happy life is if you feel like you deserve it. I gotta get more one-ups. And you do, is the thing, is what I'm getting at. You do. It's not your, like, I almost want to say it's not your decision, and I feel like maybe I should say it's not your decision. It's not your decision. You do deserve it. If you disagree with me, that's fine, whatever, but I feel like you're going to be in the same spot, the spot that I'm saying right now, where you will be dying, and you'll be like, this sucked. The end. it's your choice whether to enjoy life or not. And I know, you know, there's, psychological disorders, there's clinical depression and stuff that sort of makes that difficult. I get that. But it's your choice whether you want to do something about that. You know, it's easy for me to say because I sort of had it easy. I don't really have any, hardcore psychological disorders. But why not feel that way? You know, why not feel like, well, I'm gonna do something about this? It's hard, but it's better than not doing something about it, as far as I'm concerned. So if I didn't do anything about it, if I didn't go to therapy, if I didn't go on this fucking, I mean, I'll just say I went on a retreat called Hoffman, the Hoffman process. Highly recommend it to anybody. Very intimate process. I gotta go. Oh my god, I gotta fight Vile again? Holy fucking shit, dude. I might actually abandon this. I'm gonna be honest with you. Well, we'll see. That was the biggest thing in my life. You know, I went to personal therapy. It was helpful. It was very helpful. But I didn't feel like it got to the root of things. But I feel like Hoffman really got to the root of everything. And it's where I got that bracelet. It wasn't directly from Hoffman. It was from a Hoffman alumni. But yeah. Love yourself. Is what I'm getting at. Ah, shit! Son of a bitch. And you know, I do this comedy show, right? I do this show, Game Grumps, and I'm doing it because it's a funny show, right? I have this persona where I'm like this angry dude, right? And that's funny. But the thing is, I don't hold on to anger. Anger is a fleeting thing. Anger is a response. It's like getting your toe stubbed and going, ow. Except I make it funny. That's my job. And, I would say my talent, is making it fun to watch. And it is fun to watch, right? But I think people get this idea that I'm an angry guy, and I'm not. I'm actually a very peaceful guy. I don't hold on to anger. I don't think anybody should. But that's just me. Because it's... You don't have to. And I think in most... God damn. I think in most cases, people who do hold on to anger are holding on to some other anger, right? Like, there's something else there. It's not just... The getting the toe stubbed was just a trigger. That there was something else that, fuck! Why is this so much more difficult now? It's probably because I'm concentrating so much on talking about this shit. Yeah, so this... When you see people that, like, chronically get angry, I empathize with that, and it's because there's something else there. It's not just the thing that's happening. You know, a lot of people will try to justify it. They'll for example, I mean, I did it just the other day. So the other day, I had a really tough day. I had so much shit going on, everything was going wrong, and I sort of let it get to me. Which is not very common, for me. But it's been particularly difficult because I've been working literally every day since, leading up to the tour. I've been sick. I had to miss out on a live show that we were doing because I was sick. And I was just... There was a lot of incompetence. It was all a lot of the same kind of problem throughout the day. A lot of, like, incompetence. A lot of stuff wasn't working and people weren't doing their jobs. So that was... God fucking damn! That's what was going on with my day. And so, you know, at the end of the day... You know, Susie was like, well, you know, how was your day? And I was like, oh man, fuck this day, you know, this and that, this and that, this and that. And there are people that do that every day, is what I'm getting at. There are people that do that every single day. But I look back on that day, and it wasn't even close to, like, some of my worst days. And on some of my worst days, I just come home and I'm like, well, you know, I'm home now. Great. I get to fucking relax. I'm very tired because I had to deal with a bad day, and I'm ready to laugh and enjoy my family. So what I'm saying is, like, the people who, like, in the case of me on that day, right? Like, I was going on and on about all this and that, and justifying why I was upset because I was upset. Like, I didn't have to be upset. I just chose to hang on to it for that day, for whatever reason, which I found out was just because I was overtired, right? And doing a little meditation just made me realize that, and I was like, I'm a little overtired, okay, I'll go to sleep. I'll get some rest, I'll fucking take it easy tomorrow. And then it worked, you know? I don't think it's inherent to hang on to anger. So if you're somebody that does something and has a bad day every day and is like, oh, well, this happened and this happened and that's why I'm angry, there's probably something more there, and that's not why you're angry. People can endure a lot of stuff and still be happy, right? I've done it. I've endured a lot of physical and emotional pain all at once and just been like, you know, I got this. Because why not? Again, and it's funny because I'm in the exact same spot in the game where I said, why not, and another thing.
Why not?
But, like, why not? Like, oh, fuck yeah, Vile's dead. Great. Because why not? Why be miserable? Why indulge in the misery? There's nothing to gain. And I know maybe there's some kind of, like, hipster, like, it's cool to indulge in the pain, right? Like, I know there's definitely, like, there's this sort of, like, cisgender, you know what I mean? There's sort of, like, that quote-unquote, like, Tumblr vibe where it's like, well, you know, if you're not oppressed, then, like, fuck you. But, like, no. Not really. I choose to respect everybody. People who are having a great time and are proud of the things that they do, and people who are having a shit time. I don't think pity is the only qualifier for being likable, you know? And maybe I'm oversimplifying, but I just don't really get that. You know, it's like, I would consider myself a privileged person because I'm a white male, as is considered by some communities to be a privileged person. But I've dealt with my own hardships, and I've helped people in ways that I can, you know, and even that, I don't have to justify that. I don't have to say, like, well, you know, despite me being white and male, like, I was fucking born white and male. I can't help that. All I can do is choose to be happy and whoever I want to be and then be okay with that. And I am. What the fuck is this series? I'm going to just say right now, I'm babbling like a goddamn maniac, and it's probably like, what the fuck, but, I don't know, I'm enjoying it, why not, fuck it, you know, I talk like this in my, god damn it, I've always wanted to do a vlog series. I'll just say that right now. Anyway, next time on Game Grumps, money is a really weird thing now. Cause like, you know, obviously, there have been so many fucking, like, articles and shit about, like, oh, YouTubers, and how much money you make, and blah, blah, blah. And, I mean, I can just tell you right now, like, I'm okay, you know? in the money department. But I worked for it. You know, I built a reputation for myself in the animation world and in the YouTube world for so long. And, God, this is difficult. So I got to this point because I worked for it, and I'm here now, and I'm enjoying it, and I'm way cool with it, but I'm also trying to share the love, too. That's something I don't understand, is, when people are in a position of comfort, and, they don't give back. I'm not looking down on people for that, I just don't, to me, it's like, it's natural, it's like, well, why the fuck wouldn't I share it, right? Like, when I was so... my life sucked. And my job sucked. And I really wanted to do I was hungry. I wanted to draw and make things and make cool shit. And I just didn't have the means to do it. I wanted help, you know? I was like... Well... I wanted to work for it, of course, but... At the same time, it's like, it would have been really nice to have somebody, like, acknowledge what I was doing and be like, well, you know what, I have the means, so why don't I help you? So that's what I want to do for other people. I mean, that's what I've been trying to do for other people. And I get if you don't want to. Like I said, I'm not looking down on anybody who doesn't. I'm just saying it's just, why wouldn't you, help people out, and there's only so many people I can help out, that's the thing. You know, it's tough. It's like, you got fucking Bill and Melinda Gates, and they got, I'm all the way back here? Fuck! You got fucking Bill and Melinda Gates and their fucking, their huge charity program, and, like, holy shit, right? But, like, I got a YouTube channel, and, like, some extra cash, and a Twitter presence. Like, I'm just using what I got. So, you know, I try to invest in a lot of Patreons. I support artists by increasing their visibility, and I give animators work. That's like the extent of, and there's much more. My goal in helping people is I actually wanted to open like an art school scholarship. Because I could never afford going to art school, and I always wanted to. I always wanted to get better at art. Okay, so, yeah, so my goal is to open up a scholarship for art classes, which, you know, a scholarship for art class is very expensive, so in order to raise money for that, it would be very hard. And plus, I don't know anything about running a fucking charity. All I know is raising money for charity, and then I just hand it off to the charity. But I really want to do that. I mean, that's what I believe in. And I know there are people that would say, like, oh, well, starving kids are more important or something like that. But, like, life is all about... Oh, man, zero. You can only live your life, right? And in my life, I have developed a passion for creative people, for artists. And for me to... do a charity that's, like, about, like, you know, third world countries or something. Like, I've never been there. And I'm sure it fucking sucks there. And I can empathize with that. But, like, I'm not gonna be passionate. I'm not gonna be fucking rallying troops. I'm not gonna be like, dude, I'm not gonna be fucking crying over this stuff that they've never experienced. But I have experienced fucking being shut down. As an artist, I have experienced being, you know, underappreciated, unappreciated. Being in a hard place, you know, fucking working your ass off and not getting any recognition or and living in a shitty apartment and eating fucking ramen every day. I have experienced that, and it sucks. And so I can, I'm passionate about getting kids out of that situation. You know, which isn't as fucking noble as curing AIDS, but, yeah, it's what I care about, so I'm gonna be a lot better at it than the other thing, right? You might as well play to your strengths. That's how I feel, at least. You know, I've never been one to look down on people for following their passions, no matter what it is. You know, I feel like that's the only thing you can do in life is follow your passion, right? Because there's just so much shit in the world. You might as well do the thing that really interests you. Or else you're gonna do stuff half-assed, and nobody likes that. People who do the half-assing and the people who have to experience the half-assed being done. No, nobody likes that. Just a bad time for everybody. Wouldn't that be neat? You know, just a fucking world where everybody... Just right away, people are like, what do you like doing? And they're like, you know, I like doing this. But at the same time, like... I feel most people would be like, I like watching movies. Oh, okay. Well, we'll figure something out then. It has something to do with watching movies then. I mean, we're very fortunate. People who do YouTube, very fortunate to be doing this. It comes with its own stresses, but it is a very rewarding job. It's just a matter of taking it in moderation. And also, like, not listening to other people. That's the thing I get criticized a lot for. And it's funny, I say that because I'm literally talking about not even indulging in criticism like that. But, I've said publicly a lot that I don't read comments. And, there are people that look down on that. I would even say there are other, personalities that look down on that. My choice, and I don't feel like it's relevant to what I do. What I do is sit on a couch, play a video game, talk over it, be entertaining. And reading comments is not that. It is not that at all, and it actually hinders my ability to do that, because as much faith as I have in myself, all it takes is a real shitty comment and a real bad day to just completely ruin it. And it's really not worth the good comments. It's not. I'm gonna be fucking perfectly honest with you. It's not worth it. Because it's just not... Well, to speak to the passion thing, I'm not passionate about fucking reading comments. I'm not passionate about hearing people's opinions about or theories about fucking me and Dan. And oh, they seem to be fighting a lot recently. Like, who cares? It's none of anyone's business except for mine. And oh boy. And in any case, let me deal with that, right? I just don't want any like outside. I'm not really being super clear about what I mean. My point is just that I don't think it matters, you know? At the end of the day, what I'm doing for you is making a good show. And the way I do that is by using my abilities and my talents and my skills and my opinions on what makes a good show. And if I let other people say, well, I want this instead, then it's not really my show anymore, is it? It's the audience's show, and it's not the audience's show. The audience is watching it, and I'm very grateful that there is an audience, but it isn't the audience's show. It's my show that the audience watches, which I don't think is wrong to say at all. God fucking damn, dude. Oof. And it's my choice, you know, and I would say, I gotta get more one-ups, and I would say, you know, in the case of like, well, you know, if you don't listen, then you're gonna lose viewers. And it's like, well, okay. Even if that's the case, then that's still a choice that I have to make. Do I care? Is it about the viewers, or is it about me doing a show that I like, and that I like doing in a certain way? And that sort of goes back to the passion argument. But it's more important to me to do a show in a way that I enjoy doing it, and that sort of keeps me sane, you know? I've got a lot of shit about, not playing games well. I have a reputation in that way, which I think is really funny, and I think makes for a decent show, honestly. I think makes for a unique show, and adds to a lot of the comedy elements of it. I mean, fucking Mario Maker, come on, it's one of our most popular series, and it's largely because it's hard, and people like seeing the failure, and then the catharsis of actually beating it, and then the frustration of failing. I mean, and I think it's fun. I love, you know, blowing up over the little things. It's really fun to sort of let that out. So that's why I do it. That's one example.
No!
I used to do this podcast called Game Shout, where they sent me games and they were like, play them and review them on the show. And then they also had a website. So I actually wrote up reviews for a while. And it wasn't even a job, honestly. Actually, like, thinking back, I actually think of how naive I was. Because I wasn't paid at all for it. I just enjoyed doing it because I got free games. And just because it was, like, something to do. It made me feel legitimate. And if I ever wanted to actually do game reviewing, I had that under my belt. But anyway, I did that for a while, and the first game I played was 50 Cent Bulletproof, you know? It's like, I didn't want to play that, but, I tried to put my own spin on it. I tried to make the review funny, and, you know, I did it with, like a character. I did the whole review with a character, because it was, like, a podcast review. It was fun. But that, I mean, that's where I got my first YouTube video upload ever, the Gunpei review. I got that copy of Gunpei from that podcast, because they wanted me to review it. And I did a proper review of it, I believe. But then I did that because I was like, well, I want to do something. I didn't feel like it was worthy of an actual review. I really hated it at the time. I wonder if I'd like it now. I just remember it being this really forced, like, just an idea that wasn't quite there. And it's also like, I don't know. Gunpei Yokoi. It was designed by Gunpei Yokoi, and he's dead. And I feel like he maybe would have changed it a little bit. They just kind of like re-released it or something because it was like half designed or something. I don't remember. But anyway, that's like that's what always bothers me about like post-mortem releases, because like, I don't know. When you're an artist and you create something and you put something out there, like, there's a lot of scrutiny that you yourself as an artist gave it, right? Like, before you put it out. And then when people, like, find, like, oh man, these were, like, masterworks that he never released, it's like, yeah, well, there's probably a reason that this artist didn't release these things, because probably didn't like them. Or they probably didn't feel like they were good enough. Like, in the case of, Osamu Tezuka, he's the guy who made Astro Boy. He's considered the godfather of all manga. He had this series called Phoenix that was like his masterworks, and they're incredible. Highly recommend reading Phoenix. But so after he died, he was working on other books that were like in the vein of Phoenix, but weren't exactly Phoenix. And then they released Viz, I think is the publisher. Released them under the name Phoenix and just called them like original works or something like that. And it was like Phoenix 12. Yeah, bubble baths, dude. And it just like, it, they're not as good and they just don't feel the same. So it's kind of like, well, it just doesn't feel as right. It's like, whatever, who cares? They're out there. But, you know, obviously they were using the name to sell
some were issues. If they were just like, these are just unreleased Zoopers, whatever. Instead of being like, these are fucking Phoenix, like, oh shit.
How many lives do I got? Six? I can handle it. You know, they call me One Handle Hanson. That doesn't make any sense. This has been fun. I actually really enjoyed this. I would love to do this more often. I hope you guys did too. If you didn't, you know, whatever. I'll figure out how to make it work, I guess, because I really want to do this again. Rip me out, rip my heart out, and suck my dick, and call me Sally. My name's Arin. Enjoy. Have a good night. I love you. I really do.